Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will be discussing the basics of the bones as well as the joints of the lower limb. And as we did with the upper limb, we are just introducing the bones and joints, and we will go into more detail on certain areas in upcoming sessions. So really the goal is for us to get used to these terms, or really the names, and just get a basic understanding of where these bones and joints are located. So it'll seem like a lot of new names, and it is, but do be aware that we will talk about these in subsequent videos and learning objectives and in the lab as we go through this material. So where we had a pectoral girdle associated with the upper limb, there is a pelvic girdle that is associated with the lower limb that serves to connect the axial skeleton to the lower appendage. So again, the pelvic girdle is in an intermediate position between the trunk and the appendages. We discussed the coxal bones or the hip bones in more detail during the pelvic portion of the curriculum, but recall that there are two coxal bones that articulate with one another at the anterior pubic symphysis, which is a cartilaginous joint, and posteriorly these articulate with the sacrum at the sacroiliac or SI joints. You'll often hear it abbreviated that way. Recall that the sacrum and its close neighbor, the coccyx, are going to be the fused portions of the vertebral column. So the pelvic girdle is not only serving to connect to the axial skeleton, which the vertebral column certainly is, but specifically a portion of the vertebral column, which is unique, that did not occur with the pectoral girdle. The coxal bones will articulate with the head of the femur at the acetabulum, which you can see a little bit of it right here on the sides. Then that forms the hip joint, which is, similar to the shoulder joint, is a ball and socket joint and thus highly mobile, but doesn't have the same degree of range of motion as we saw in the shoulder. Moving to the thigh, there is a single bone per thigh called the femur, which just so happens to be the longest bone in the body. And as mentioned, the head of the femur will articulate with the coxal bone to form the hip joint. The distal portions of the femur will articulate with the tibia and the patella to form the complex knee joint. And we will spend quite a bit of time breaking down the details of the knee in future sessions, as it's a frequently injured area, therefore very clinically relevant. Moving to the leg, we have a pair of bones. We will have the medial, considerably larger tibia. It's also going to be the weight-bearing bone in the leg, and then the fibula, which is lateral and relatively thin compared to certainly the tibia. And really, only the tibia is going to play a direct articulation role in the knee joint. The fibula, you see, doesn't quite reach the femur, so not playing a role specifically in the articulation of the knee joint, but there will be ligaments that attach to the fibula. Both the tibia and the fibula will articulate in differing ways to the talus, which is one of your tarsal bones, in order to form the talocrural or ankle joint distally. And you can palpate on the lateral side of your ankle region and you will be feeling the fibula, whereas on the medial side, if you palpate around the ankle region, you're feeling the tibia. Similar to what we had with the radius and ulna, the tibia and fibula will articulate with one another in three regions, thus forming three separate joints. There will be a proximal tibiofibular joint, as well as a distal tibiofibular joint. And then you will have an intermediate tibiofibular joint that connects the bodies or the shafts of the tibia and fibula via an interosseous membrane, so an example of a fibrous joint. In the ankle and hind foot region, there will be 7 tarsal bones, so one less tarsal bone than carpals, but these are notably larger in size. And I do want you now to be able to identify 2 of these, specifically the talus or the talus. Sometimes you hear it referred to as that. This is going to be the more superiorly positioned tarsal bone. And so it will proximally articulate with both the tibia and the fibula, as we mentioned at the talocrural joint or that ankle joint. And it will also articulate with some of the other tarsal bones at intertarsal joints. But in particular, I want you to focus on this articulation with the calcaneus, which is this large bone here, often referred to as the heel bone, at the subtalar joint. And we'll come back to this joint in terms of talking about some specific actions that occur in the foot region. The 4 distal tarsal bones will articulate with the metatarsals at the tarsometatarsal joints. There are 5 metatarsals, similar to what we had with the metacarpals of the hand, but a big difference here is that the first metatarsal, which you have right here, is the medialmost metatarsal, rather than the lateralmost as we had with the first metacarpal. So the first metatarsal, is associated with the big or the great toe. And we'll continue in sequence from medial to lateral. So that's the first, this would be the second, the third, the fourth, and the fifth metatarsal. As mentioned, the metatarsals will articulate with 4 of those distal tarsals at the tarsometatarsal joints, and distally, the metatarsals will articulate with proximal phalanges at the metatarsophalangeal joint, which is a mouthful for sure, so very often abbreviated as MP or MTP joints. The organization of the phalanges of the toes is extremely similar to the phalanges of the fingers, and they do have the same name. So the good thing is if you learn the pattern for one, you will know the pattern for the other. So this means that there are 5 proximal phalanges, 4 intermediate phalanges, so we're missing an intermediate phalange associated with the first digit, and 5 distal phalanges. The joints between the proximal and intermediate phalanges are going to be the proximal interphalangeal or PIP joints, and the joint between the intermediate and distal phalanges are the distal interphalangeal or DIP joints. All right, we have reached the summary slide that has this handy table of the bones and joints we have discussed. Again, these are a lot of new names, and you will become more familiar with these as we continue our discussions within musculoskeletal anatomy. So begin getting used to these terms and realize that these will continue to come up, and we'll add some familiarity as we go. Thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.